Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to DreamHack Open 2015 Valencia. We are just about to get into the round of 32 here for the StarCraft II tournament as we've got, well, winding down. We're in the bracket, the elimination stage, only so many players remaining.
So excited for this one. Starting it off with Arium versus Symbol. That's actually one hell of a match. I'm really curious to see how far Arium can go. Symbol is, you know, not the strongest Korean we have here either. Like, I definitely think he has a shot at taking him down.
Examples. Yeah, there's a lot of cool matchups coming up, and we can dive a bit more into that one. Of course, let's take a look at the bracket just to keep you guys all up to date on what matches are going to be coming up. You guys can let me know. Who do you like in this bracket? Of course, as you pointed out in the top right, we have that lone American flag here.
That's right. I'm really looking forward to seeing what happens with Terminator versus Gumiho as well. Two big Korean names matching up this early. Should be pretty interesting. I'm not sure who would make it out of that one.
Yeah, should be pretty close. I think I would favor Gumiho in that one for sure. But we'll see what Terminator's brought. We haven't seen him just yet.
I mean, all the other players got to be very happy that Fantasy and Gumiho are put in that side of the bracket.
Because yeah.
They're probably, you know, it's a very even tournament. But if you had to pick two guys who probably are relatively favored, they'd be the two. And looking at the bracket as a whole, you know, I can sort of see this being like Tejas springboard back, you know, after a long time of sort of like mediocre results. His side of the bracket isn't, I mean, there are some tough players like Zoxer or Young, but I don't know. I like Tejas' chances now.
Yeah, for sure. I think the left side of the bracket is a bit harder in terms of the Koreans that are over there. You know what I'm saying? But you really raise a good point about Fantasy and Gumiho. They can knock each other out like really, really soon.
It really makes me think back to just, you know, the fact that Harstam 2-0'd Gumiho in that group. If you replaced Gumiho in that bracket, if you just swapped his spot with Harstam right now, you'd have a much happier Gumiho and a Harstam that's like, oh, goodness. But now things are looking a lot better, I'd say, for Harstam at least. And then Gumiho. Yeah. Gumiho and Fantasy both being in the same quadrant.
Yeah.
Players that we kind of talked, or at least, you know, even pre-show, we talked a lot about being players that we would look to see towards the end.
Another player that we kind of skimmed over was Curious, and he's in the bottom left of that bracket, and he's by himself. You know, there's no one there that's really a threat. There's not really any other big Korean names down there. It's him with a bunch of foreigners. He could make it pretty far. He could maybe be meeting Fantasy or Gumiho, you know, further down the bracket.
It's unfortunate that Bunny, after, you know, knocking out Lobo, and he wants to get these WCS points, and then he runs into that side of bracket with Curious. I mean, obviously, his chances of getting an easy bracket side, you know, they were low, but he could have hoped. But now he's going to run the Curious probably in another round or two.
At least he gets the Terran versus Zerg you wanted, right?
That's true.
That, to me, is the most interesting part of all this, because, you know, even have players like Marine Lord, they're like, if I have to play a Korean, give me a Zerg. They don't know how to handle my mech. You know, these guys all studying from the Book of Avalo, they're very good with their Ravens. Anybody that tuned into Season 2 Finals got to see a lot of late-game mech play from those guys, especially against Zergs. But, you know, this matchup that we have at hand, you know, the only American in the tournament, one of the only tournaments he's actually able to play in because he's so young, Arium against Symbol, who, as you guys are kind of alluding to, not quite in the same level, we'd say, as the rest of the Koreans in this tournament.
Yeah, he certainly hasn't been performing very well in Korea. We've seen him a couple of times come out in Pro League and try in these individual leagues, and he hasn't had that much success. He made it to CODES last season, but he got knocked out when it came to the group stage. So it's hard to really pinpoint where he's at, but the team isn't using him enough in Pro League. So we're kind of thinking that he just probably isn't going to perform very well.
I think if there's one Zerg who's a Korean that you are going to face here in this round of 32, I think Symbol's the guy for Arium to just be like, okay, I go ahead really aggressive. Maybe I take a quick series here against Symbol. I think Arium could actually do it.
I think, though, Symbol is giving us, like, weird mixed signs because, one, he was in CODES last season, and he could be in CODES again this season, depending on how his challenger match goes. Mm. At the same time, he's basically a Pro League bench warmer. He plays behind Rogue. And, you know, Rogue's a good player, but, like, if you're behind Rogue, I don't know. It says something about your level.
I think we're going to get a good look at his condition going into this tournament as we get into the next series, which we are just about ready to do. So I'm going to kick it off over to you guys for your PVZ action. It's going to be Arium versus Symbol.
Welcome back, guys, over here. We're about to start the round of 32 match. I'm so excited to get into this one. As Nate mentioned, it's going to be a PVZ.
I can't wait to see how Symbol's going to be playing. Yeah, it's delicious, Valdez. Finally, another Zerg we get to talk about.
I'm sure you're happy about this, Ming Lei.
It's been a while, mate. But either way, it's I'm very curious to see where he's at right now, because we don't get to see him get played out that much, because he is behind Rogue when it comes to his team in Pro League, and that's definitely a case of it. But I think like if he was doing much better, they'd put him out with Rogue or instead of Rogue. Like Rogue isn't like the be all end all when it comes to that either.
For sure, for sure. I'm really curious how he's going to feel in this foreign tournament as well, flying all the way to Valencia. It's also a big issue sometimes for the Korean players that are not used to it. Mm. You know, I don't think he's the biggest traveler amongst many Koreans.
He's had some experience though. He has been around for a long time, and he certainly has traveled in the past, but it has been a while. He doesn't really get these trips very often. Yeah.
But we'll see what he's going to be able to do here. I'm very curious about the map pool as well, like what maps got through here, because we saw it before Arium, you know, he can definitely go very aggressive against these Zergs. I'm sure he's going to be wanting those two-player maps just put on the pressure. But we are jumping into the first map here on the right side of the map. Bridgehead, the red Zerg. It is Symbol.
And on the left side, as the blue Protoss, we do have Arium, the American Hope.
Wearing that flag. Yep. I don't see it now, though. Looks like he's getting down to business.
Probably a little
around the 32.
Probably a little hot in there with the flag on, I can imagine.
Yeah, and that could even burden your, you know, your, I don't know, your play. Maybe get to your shoulders.
Make your shoulders a little too tight to use that mouse and keyboard, Valdez.
Yeah.
I think you might be right there.
Yeah, I don't think he would, you know, seriously put that on. It looks like he just had that on during the breaks between the games, but regardless, he is the only American player in the bracket. We'll see if he's going to be able to make it through.
Yeah, absolutely. This is an interesting map to start on, Bridgehead. Obviously, one of these newer maps, and we are seeing Symbol go for that early drone. We'll see where he's going to put it exactly. Is he going to go for a proxy? Or is he going to go, you know, just to maybe try and block? I mean, we have seen a lot of sort of play here. We've certainly seen it in the Korean leagues where you throw down a hatchery there, DPS down those rocks, and go from behind, and really can really mix them up. I'm sure he's going to be scouting for it there, but it's interesting that he's actually putting it at the base instead.
Yeah, you know, sometimes you want to get it close to the rocks just so you can have the creep over there, you know, get a spine crawler down, get those queens working at it, but looks like he wants to take an actual base at the same time as opening up that option. It really does just come down to, is Arium going to scout it? Do you see him dropping down both gases now at this point?
Yeah, both gases very early on, so it leads us to believe he wants to perhaps be a little aggressive. Maybe want to get a tech out a little bit earlier, or at least a stalker and a mothership and whatnot. But he should be scouting it pretty early. It's kind of an important scout. We have seen the likes of Classic scout it before, and he kind of just chrono boosted out a bunch of Zealots and crushed it.
Yeah, it can be easier to deal with, especially if you do get that scouting information down. By the way, scouting that also very popular place to put a proxy hatch up this ramp. It's really close to the front ramp.
Yeah, that's right. He's going to look up here, but you know what? He is in an interesting place. He's not sitting next to the rocks with his hatchery. He is a bit further up, so if Arium was a little careless, he might miss it, but it looks like he will catch it. Oh! There we go.
Oh, man.
Oh, man. The creep was just about to pop as well. See, this is exactly what I was thinking, because it's just that little bit further up. He's
that is so funky. He sees the drones, though. He should know.
He should know. If he was paying attention, he knows.
Well, at the same time, it's going to be a robotics facility in the back of his base. And, wow, this is going to turn into a funky game, Moonglade. I'm already getting excited.
Oh, man. Funky indeed. Good word. He's going to scout it now. He sees his link speed on the way. Sees the gas. Doesn't scout any further than that. Maybe he did have an idea that it's there. But he's still checking bases, Valdez.
Yeah. You know, he may just not be 100% certain at this point in time. He's going to keep that probe out on the map as well. It looks like he wants to put down possibly a pylon for a forward warping point a little bit later on in this game. But this hatchery is up and mining, and out comes the first queen here.
Yeah, I think he must know that it's there, because he threw down a robo. I mean, throwing down a robo this early on one base, surely it must be that he's planning to kind of deal with it. And there we go. There's the immortal. So he knows. He saw those drones. But you can never be too sure of Valdez.
Yeah, I think you should know. Funnily enough, Symbol sending out a scouting Zergling on the map. He just barely misses the probe, so this is turning into the game where both these guys are missing the actual information.
Yeah, look at that. Two spores as well. This is actually really funky from Symbol, because he's forcing out immortals. But what if they're not useful? What if he's just going to mine from this base and play a normal game? He's forced this one base build out from Arium. And from here, things could get pretty awkward.
nice scout over here. He knows the timing for when those Zerglings should be getting to work on those rocks, so just going to get that Mothership Core in position. But Queen there to protect. A lot of Lings being produced at this point in time, staying on 21 workers. He really wants to put on the pressure.
Yeah, nothing but Lings. Essentially all in at this point. I don't know if he can really come back from, you know, he's going to have to do some really critical damage and then drone up again. He's starting to drone again right now, but I mean, he just committed to so many Zerglings. He's not going to do anything either.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. At the same time, this War Prism is out on the map.
There's a good word for this kind of game, Valdez, and that's Wonka Doodle.
Is that something?
That's
Wonka Doodle.
This is certainly that kind of game, Valdez.
It's a Wonka Doody game.
Well, let's see what happens. We are actually seeing more Immortals being made as well, and Spine Call is not going to last very long against them, but he's making them to try and DPS down this debris.
So the Warp Prism went all the way across the map, and it didn't pick up anything, and it came all the way back. So there all you right. go. This Warp Prism is going to be very effective at picking up these units and microing them against everything that the Zerg has to offer over here. Doing a really nice job of that, just really taking off the pressure at that backdoor rocks. More Lynx coming across the map.
Yeah, I think he brought a bunch back to kind of defend against that Warp Prism that was empty. And now he's pressuring the front here. Still on one base, mind you. This is a big thing to remember. Arium still on one base. It's two base for Symbol, but you know he did commit to so many Zerglings, so much army early. Nice force field. It's going to claim a lot of Lynx for this.
Yeah, not bad. Arium at least prepared. But as you did mention, still no second base. Not even taking his backdoor natural.
Yeah, more Lynx going down as well. So a little careless play there from Symbol. But, I mean, he's still making Lynx, Valdez. He's actually just gearing up for that big hit.
Yeah, it is going to be tough, even so, for Arium to deal with this. Once those rocks go down, he's going to have his sentries in position. He's going to have to chain a bunch of force fields.
He's going to need a pretty impressive SimCity right now, and I'm wondering if he does actually have that, because so many Lings are coming down. Not many force fields either.
Looks like he's just making a mini wall at the back of his main. Look at that. He's just going to try to make a wall of pylons and make it so it's only one force field wide, and at the same time go for an immortal drop at the main of Symbol.
Yeah, I could definitely do a lot of damage looking at these armies. There's some Lings waiting, just enough Lings actually. And so many Lings sitting outside the main of Arium.
Oh, big Warpin over here trying to get a bunch of Zealots to support those Immortals. Great micro there on the Immortals and out of the Warp Prism, keeping them in full health.
Yeah, that was beautiful. They haven't lost any real HP yet, in just a little bit.
This kind of play is fantastic, man. I'm really enjoying his play so far. Just one base Protoss getting out four Immortals on Bridgehead. And now that he's in the main, he can even force field the ramp. It's pretty wide, but...
Well, if he gets the sentry and he can, but, you know, he is on one base. Only two gases here, so he's going to have a hard time doing that. Lings are coming in to clean this up. They're just going to buy Arium more time to sit on one base and make an army that's going to deal with Mass Ling. More and more Immortals coming in. I'm kind of surprised we aren't seeing a Forge go down, perhaps, with plus one. That would
be so smart.
That would be the hard counter to this in a nutshell.
It seems like he's just going to sit here on one base and make as many Immortals as he can.
21 drones from Symbol, by the way, as we saw Funko point out there.
Yeah.
It's not much of an economy at all.
Looks like he does fully wall off at the back of his main there. And it's going to be very hard for those Lynx to ever get by. Still no Forge. And he's got like six sentries, it looks like. At the same time, going for a very nice drop over here. He's got to be careful about that War Prism, though. Just going to be forced to back off now.
Yeah, well, still, just mine. Looks like Symbol's going back into droning now. He's maybe realized that Mass Zerglings were never going to do really anything that he hoped would happen. So, Arium, you know, he's still in this by a big way, but he maybe should capitalize sooner, or at least take a base now that the threat is gone, that these Mass Zerglings will actually get anything done. Still making that one base army, though.
Yeah, floating so much gas at the same time. He could make more sentries. I guess he just doesn't want them. He wants to make as many Zealots as possible, going for a possible harass at the main base eventually. He's grouped up, I think, like six Zealots in the top right.
Yeah, he does have a lot of Zealots up there.
Wow.
Seems to be just, yeah, really building up a little army. He's going to probably drop those two Immortals there at some point as well. And go for some. The Lings are just waiting for anything to come out of that base. At this point, I think Arium's completely blocked off both sides. So he can't really march his way down until he at least kills the debris at the bottom there, or one of those pylons up top.
I have to say, these new maps, a lot of people complain about them, but they make the most interesting and fun Wonka Doodle Doo games we've made.
They do indeed, Valdez. And here we go again. A lot of Zealots coming up here. Not sure if there's going to be enough Lings this time. It's going to depend on the position as well. And these Zealots get up the ramp. They're chasing the War Prism. And it's coming in hot.
So many Zealots in here. Of course, no plus one. Here come the Immortals as well. Trying to get a pylon down. Looks like that will be taken out. No, he's going to commit to try to getting these Immortals. Ooh. But again, really nice micro here from Arium.
Yeah, really nice. Keeping those Immortals alive once again. The Zealots have a great position. And now Symbol's in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, these Zealots are just doing critical damage at this point. A bunch of Zealots going outside the base to try to deal with the Lings that are coming back. In the meantime, a Rogehorn has been built and some Roaches are trying desperately to micro against the Zealots.
Well, they certainly do well against the Zealots, but these Immortals working on the lair right now. Mortlings coming in there. They should be forcing the Immortals to lift at some point. Still, I think a lot of damage has been done. I mean, no mining whatsoever. Five drones also went down.
Yeah, so all he's got is the mining at that base, towards the base of Arium. These two Immortals are so, so low.
Yeah, they're so low. And still Zealots alive, actually, as well. Look
at that. A Spire on the way.
All right, we are seeing a transition here. Spire of essentially one base mining at this point. So many Zealots just got warped in as well, and there's two Immortals alive enough to kill the Roaches. Could even work on that Roach Warren if he wanted to.
Yeah, getting it to half health, the lair also really low. He's going to try to micro here. The Zealots are doing a great job walling off and protecting those Immortals.
Oh, that micro on the Immortals is absolutely amazing here.
Unbelievable, man.
Truly a beautiful thing, and there's only Roaches left over at this point. He's going to have to give up the base.
He's going to lose his Roach Warren. Looks like the speed is going to finish just barely, but he's not going to have any Roaches to use it.
Yeah, it's just not going to be very useful. Broodling's almost claiming the life of an Immortal. That Immortal on like one HP right now. He's dropping him.
Oh, man.
This guy.
This is so fantastic.
He cleans up the Roaches. Just beautiful micro. This guy, his micro was something else. I'm so impressed.
Oh, yeah. They were talking about how his blink micro is incredible, but at the same time, what? He's going to use a bunch of hallucinated archons to tank the spine crawlers. GG.
Wow.
Arium.
Yes. He's loving it.
Oh, man.
What a weird game, Valdez.
That was awesome, man. I'm so happy I got to cast that game.
Pure mass Lings on two base and about 20 drones against the one base Immortal tech from Arium. It was the right choice in the end, though, and he made all the right moves.
I would have loved to see the kill count on both of those Immortals. They survived till the very end.
Oh, that is
those
true.
Those two Immortals.
That is a good point. That is absolutely insane.
Yeah.
I can't believe it, man.
Keep in mind that very nearby is Symbol. You know, he may have even seen like Arium go for this in the celebration with all the Archons.
I hope he did, man, because that was such a weird strategy from Symbol as well. Like he had no intention of playing a normal game. No intention of like, I don't know. Yeah. He just wanted to kill him with mass Lings no matter what he saw. He's like, well, okay, you blocked off your base, mass Ling. Oh, it's that you're I don't know.
I'm going to poke at these rocks.
I'm going to poke at the rocks.
In the back of your back door natural.
I'm just going to
do nothing.
I'm going to make Lings. I'm going to stay on 20 drones and your one base Immortal tech going to take me down.
Yeah.
It was so strange. I mean, it would have been even easier if we saw Arium go for that plus one Zealots as well, you know?
Oh, yeah. I'm sure he could have fitted in. He was floating like 700 gas at some point.
He had no desire of transitioning past Lings for the longest time. It was a weird style.
And then he finally got out the Roachworn and then a Spire, and he was making like five mutas because he couldn't support it. He wasn't mining gas in his main. He had one base of gas, and he was like trying to save for five mutas. Kind of a strange game for sure from Symbol. We'll see if he can win two in a row against Arian.
Do you think it's like a lack of confidence for the map, perhaps? Like, I don't think it's that bad of a map for Zerg at all against Protoss. It's not horrible, but to kind of throw out that kind of strategy is something else.
Yeah. For sure. But anyway, guys, we're going to jump into game number two right now on Dash and Terminal. The first time we're going to see it tonight. And up here in the top in the red, our Zerg player, it is Symbol.
Playing a very interesting game one. Down here in the mid right, we do have the player up a game, Arium. Playing fantastically. His micro is something else.
Yeah, that it is. They were talking about his Blink Stalker micro, but we saw his Immortal drop War Prism micro there at the same time.
Now, I wouldn't be surprised if we did see, you know, an early hatchery at these gold, but we'll see how Symbol wants to play this. He obviously doesn't want to play too much of a normal style. You know, he went for that early drone last time. Let's see if he's going to move one out this time. or maybe he'll just go back to the normal game as he's obviously doesn't want to drop another one.
Yeah. I'm sure for Symbol, the Korean pride does have a factor in this. He's like, oh, I don't want to go down to Ariam, this, you know, this 15-year-old American. You know, I got to play safe from here, maybe play that standard macro style, try to get at least one game, you know, and a bit of a longer one, not let Ariam to do what he did in that last game, at least.
Yeah, that's right. Well, he can't afford to drop a single game. He's just out of the tournament as well. Yep. So it all comes down to this for Symbol. Let's hope it's not Mass Links again. I don't think it will be, though. He's still on one base, and it looks like he's looking for that safe pool. Yeah, I like that.
I like it too. This is showing exactly what I was saying. You know, Symbol, he just wants to play safe, straight up style on this map. As long as you don't go for that golds or any crazy bases, it's pretty long rush distance on this map. You can defend it decently. Yeah, that's the Zerg.
That is true. And there we go. I mean, there's always the worry of that, of those rocks as well, that extra entrance into your natural. Can cause a bit of a problem. I'm sure if a Protoss set up shop outside there, maybe went for an Immortal in with a pylon behind that debris, kills the debris, goes on in. You could actually find like such a powerful position there. I'm sure there's a lot of things you could do, a lot of ways in.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting to see if, you know, Symbol, we were talking about how he was trying to penetrate the one base play of Ariam on that map, which he was just able to make buildings on both sides and just totally wall it off. But on this map, three entrances to that natural, as you were talking about.
Yeah, that is also a problem for Protoss.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's going to have the sickest sort of Sim City. Yeah. He wants to try and keep that safe.
You got to put some buildings towards the back door of your natural, I suppose. And then there's a front door, which is a pretty big choke. Not the biggest, but it's decently large. And then, of course, you got the rocks, which will take a decent amount of time to come down. But
yeah, it also makes you wonder, like, why, as a Zerg player, you wouldn't go for pretty early gas in this map, get Link speed out early, and apply pressure to the natural. Could also be another way to go about it, but I think Symbol's been shaken up enough that he's just simply going to go straight into that macro game, where he knows he probably has that mechanical advantage as one of these pro gamers from Korea that are living in a team house all day long, just practicing mechanics.
Two Links trying to get to work at one sentry. Actually getting it pretty low. He's going to force some probes off the line. Kind of funny how that works.
Yeah, taking a little bit of damage there. Cannot afford to lose a sentry this early. He's coming back for more.
I want to point out, Ariam is totally foregoing trying to get that early natural, and he is going for Immortals again.
He's doing the same exact style. Now that is interesting because it's going to be a different situation this time around.
Yeah, maybe if he can get a force field on the ramp, you know, because the air distances on this map are pretty short. We like to call this one Fat Scrap Station.
That's right. Indeed
it's,
it
it's
is.
A, it's a bit longer than Scrap Station in terms of air distances, but it's still decently short.
Yeah.
Considering the pool.
Well, there's an actually nice position on that probe as well. See if the Lings are going to look for it. But, yeah, I wonder how this is going to work out. Surely it can do a lot of work, especially if there's a War Prism to keep these Immortals alive. But Symbol should know for sure this is coming.
Yeah, I don't think he should be taken by surprise in this game, at least. Already two sentries out here. It looks like he is one Immortal already made here. He is going to hide that successfully. I mean, it's pretty obvious what's going on here. I don't think Symbol needs to really see it, but...
No, there's that War Prism as well. Pretty late word form, but Links have been made to intercept any sort of War Prism play.
Yeah, and as long as Symbol can hold this off, he's going to have three bases. He can easily drone out there. He's going to have sick production. So really the goal here for Symbol is just holding off this first push.
Yeah, just going into that powerful roach composition. If you have roaches out against this kind of one base play, it should be more than enough to overwhelm it. We're going to see this harassment begin here. I think certainly is just a form of harassment. I don't think RM's looking for the GG with this small drop. He's just simply setting up for a bigger movement here. Just more Immortals coming out. Saving up that probe as well.
This build is so funny. You just don't see this anymore, but it's almost as if Ariam is saying, okay, new map pool, this is viable. Once again, one base Protoss against Zerg. So far, it's been working out, but...
So far, I feel like this situation is a lot different this time around.
Oh, gets his queen force fielded here.
Beautifully done.
Gonna lose one of them. Well, he's gotta focus it down. He's trying to get it. There you go.
Saves. Oh, I lost the sentry. All right.
And that War Prism is getting pretty low.
Yeah. Well, at least it was a sentry and not the immortal.
Sentry getting a little too far ahead of himself, but War Prism once again in position to stop this. There's a lot of Zerg units already out on the map.
Yeah, and from here, Symbol can essentially just keep making them. He's going into Lair now. He's going to get Roach Speed out. It's going to make it even easier for him to fight against this kind of army composition. So I wonder what the end game is for Arm. Is he just simply going to make an army big enough to try and fight it no matter what? Because, you know, immortals are good. They're not that good.
Well, he seems to think they are. He just continues to produce them off of one base. It's sort of funny from us coming from a Korea. We never see this style of play. This just doesn't happen. But he's making it work so far.
It's probably like, it's actually taboo in like the Kesper houses. Like, you cannot actually play like this. This is unacceptable. You have to have at least five bases and macroing like a god.
Yeah. You're not allowed to play one place, one base anything.
Certainly not, but you know, I'm excited to see how this is going to end out.
I mean, he's got so many immortals out on the map, but the production, once again, from Simbl, you can even see it in the supplies. He's got three hatcheries. He's got 45 drones. It's not a gigantic number, but it's enough to pretty consistently make a decent amount of units here to defend against what RM's throwing at him. I mean, every once in a while he can drop like this and kill one Zergling, but
maybe it'll add up over time, Valdez. Give it some time. There's also some, you know, Roaches is waiting for it. Roach is still pretty slow, you know, Roach speed still on the way, and a Hydrogen as well. And it's a pretty healthy number of immortals, but it doesn't have much of a buffer, which is a problem when you're going to go up against a lot of Roaches and Hydras. You need, like, at least a lot of force fields to help out. I'm just waiting for now, though.
Well, here we go, Ling's waiting. He's going to send one forward to scout and see where that army is, and maybe try to run into the main. He's got a lot of speedlings.
Oh, that immortal exposed. Caught out. Is he going to turn around and save this? He needs every immortal at this point.
No warpers this time.
Force fields are good. Wow.
He saves it, but the Lings, they're going to run into the...
Oh, man.
Oh, there's a full wall.
There's
okay.
A full wall. All
well.
Right. Still, either way, it's going to maybe... I mean, he loses his cyber core at this point, which is a big problem.
Yeah, gonna make his first stalker of the night. So we got like five immortals in this push, but already Hydras are making his, you know, coming out. He's got a really nice concave behind those rocks.
Oh, these things are still going. Hoping in a zealot now. You know, that's not a bad composition against what we see.
All of
them
force fields are fantastic. But he's still fighting into a really big concave. Can he really make this work?
Ooh, mothership core getting low. Got rid of a few units there. It was actually a nice engagement, but you know, the bases, it's two bases versus three bases versus one. The supplies, the production, the economy, everything is so far ahead for Simbl.
Yeah, it really is. But forcing the drones to be pulled here actually going to hurt the economy of Simbl just a bit.
Oh man. It's not a good fight at all for Simbl, actually.
Now, a lot of those roaches are trying to go into that choke, but you can't go in there, not with this many sentries.
No, that was a huge blunder there. I mean, Roaches are going to evaporate against this many immortals.
But at the same time, he is running out of force fields, and the drones are being pulled, trying to go for a surround.
DPSing down Roaches and Hydras now, but it looks like things finally got tied up. The drones are proving to be one hell of a buffer as well, and it looks like the army is going to get cleaned up.
Yeah, and now Arium on 39 supply. Going to stay in the game, going to still try to make it work, but I think Simbl's got this one.
Yeah, at this point, there's really not much you can do when you're down, you know, 60 supply. GG.
GG. Simbl will take game number two, and we will go to game three in this best of three series.
It's an interesting style from Arium, but I feel like if you're going to be playing against a three base Zerg like that, you have such a small timer. Like, you're going to run out of time in a few minutes because their production is just out of control. Their supplies are going to get way too big, whether it be simply mass roaches. If we saw, like, just mass roaches overwhelm this army before it even moved across the map, that could happen as well.
Yeah. But I do, at the same time, like the way that Simbl played it. You know, on that map, it is pretty easy to defend once you get up your three bases. If they want to come through the rocks, you got a perfect concave with roaches and hydras. Mm. You know, I really have to point out, Arium's force fields look exactly like Partings. There's only, like, maybe two or three Protosses that always do that, where the force fields seem to all come down at the same time. You know what they mean? They queue it up, and it's like, whomp.
Yeah.
It's like a wall goes like this.
Very quick wall, yeah. No, he definitely has great mechanics, like great micro and force fielding. Like, he's certainly got on top of that. It's just interesting seeing that style, you know, going for that one-base style. That's something we'd never, ever see anymore.
I would love to see him just play that, you know, that newer age Protoss against Zerg where you get out plus two blank and you get a bunch of sentries and just try to fight like that. Because if you've got Partings like, force fields like Parting, then You know, I think you can take out a Zerg like Symbol.
Well, it's just about the mechanics behind that as well. Like, does he actually have the core mechanics to, you know, sit there and play a powerful 3-base Protoss that's going to take you into the late game from there? And yeah, we'll find out on this map. This is a much more economy sort of map, I think.
Yeah, I believe so. But down here in the bottom right in the red, our Zerg player, he is Symbol.
And up here in the top left, we do have Arium.
Yeah, we'll see what he decides to do on this map. If he goes one beast again, I'm just gonna... I don't know.
You're gonna lose your mind, Valdez?
I'm gonna lose my mind.
Yeah, it would be interesting. I'd be kind of disappointed at the same time. I'd love to see him just play a huge macro game. It is a good map for it.
Even like a 2-baser. Just like set up a wall and get out 7 gates to do something crazy. Like Arium is known for that style, but I definitely do not want to see what he did in the last couple of games on this map.
Yeah, game one, it kind of made sense because it was dealing with a proxy hatchery. So it kind of, and mass zerglings. But game two, maybe it was just simply giving up for the map. It's like, well, I'm going to try something a little crazy because the map is so hard for, you know, to get a natural on and hold it because of how many entrances there are to your base.
Yeah.
We're actually seeing a gateway at the top of the ramp there.
Yeah. You don't really see this all too often these days. I think, like, the only Protoss from Korea who's doing it sometimes is Son. But... yeah, I don't know. I don't like the way this is going already, Moonglade. I don't know. He's going to make another wall, and I'm like, hey, here comes the robo.
Don't worry. I got faith, Valdez. I think we're going to see maybe a little bit more. He's going to throw down, you know, the gateway, the simulator, probably the cyber, keep a block. But yeah, certainly not starting off very economically, that's for sure.
Yeah. And the Symbol on the other side of the thing, the map, is going to put down his own hatchery and then go into gas and then the pool. Very greedy build from him, but
yeah, looking,
it's going to be okay.
Looking for Zergling speed early enough, maybe to apply pressure, or maybe to kind of stop what we've been seeing from Arium a little bit easier. Have Ling speed out in the map, can shut down the drops a little bit quicker, can chase them down, can look around the map for pylons and probes, which did cause a problem last game as well.
Yeah, so Arium's sitting here on one gas still, and he's going to pump out a Zealot to wall that off. And he will go for this expand, so we won't be seeing a one base Arium play this game at least. And I like it. I wouldn't have liked to see it on this map.
Yeah, it'd be hard to see if it would actually work out on this kind of map as well.
It's like we find out that's the only build that he does, actually. It's just the Arium build.
The Arium build, man. Hey, he's made it this far. Maybe it works. Maybe Symbol just, he kind of got an idea of what to do against it. But,
I mean, if you look at the stats for Arium, his best matchup by far is PvZ. And I'm sure part of it is that Zergs just don't expect that to happen. They're like, wait, you're making this many Immortals and you're still on one base for this long? And then maybe Zergs just don't really know how to deal with it. It's been a while since they've had to play against this kind of one base Protoss style.
Yeah, it certainly throws you off. And it certainly threw Symbol off in a big way in game number one. Very slow third base for Symbol. Oh, none so far, but no doubt going to be looking for it soon. He's probably just worried about this one base style that he keeps seeing from Arium. He's just like, well, I'm going to get my gas up and running a little bit earlier, Link speed up perhaps. Very quick lair this time there. Okay, so maybe he's going to be the one applying pressure here. Ooh, now this is interesting. What if he went for like quick 2-base muta? Wouldn't that be something?
That would be kind of cool, actually. We've been seeing some Zergs try it on different maps, you know, like I almost called it Moonglade Madness.
You can call it that if you want, but
Moonlight Madness, where you got out a bunch of mutas very, very fast. There's that traditional spine crawler coming out in the front, and that just may be what we see.
It's giving me flashbacks of ZVT right now, going for that 2-base muta style. We are seeing Ling's check every corner of the map, making sure no probes are on it to apply, throw down a pylon and create some sort of disaster. But look at that, very early Blink Stalkers. Now this is actually a pretty good idea against early mutas as well. If you apply the, if you go for timing, you start applying the pressure early enough, maybe you can just kill him.
Yeah, for sure. It really comes down to how fast he can get out these mutas. He has taken all four of his gases at this point. He's trying to save up as much as possible. There goes the Spire.
There it goes. All right. Ooh, in the natural too. I'm not sure about that. That could be a bit of a mistake if we do see Arium go for this aggression.
second spine crawler going to be made? This may just be like respect towards our enemies. Like, I know you're an aggressive player. I'm just going to do this just to make sure.
Yeah.
Because usually you only see one.
There we go. He does see the blink is on the way. So he knows exactly what's going on here. I wouldn't be surprised if we do see a few more spines go down and link speed is starting to be upgraded. Is it all going to come out too late is the next question there.
Yeah. Link speed purely a response to the blink coming out here, as you mentioned. And yeah, he's got a decent amount of links. He's actually going to cancel that second spine.
Oh, wow.
Feeling like he doesn't need it at this point. It's going to be a pretty all-in two-baser from Arium, kind of what I expected. Six gates, or maybe even seven in total coming down here.
Wow. Well, let's see if he can get it up and running in time. Because this is essentially the same from Symbol's point of view. He's making the muters in just a moment's time. Link speed on the way. He's got Lings maybe looking on the map for some. But he's going to have to be out on the map as he will not want to be fighting Blinkstalkers head on. And look at this, a pylon so close to the natural. This could be disastrous if he doesn't find it.
It really could. At the same time, Symbol, he may just decide to go for a bit of a base trade. Once you get out these meters, you can just go straight to the Protoss base. He's going to have all his units out on the map. But also, you got to worry about that recall ability. We'll see how a Symbol decides to deal with this pressure. I mean, he saw the blink. He should know what's happening here from Arian.
Yeah, he has the blink. And we are seeing a couple more spines go down now. And Muta's going to run into Blink Stalkers.
He's going to lose one of them this early on, and a blink going to get another one very, very low.
Oh, it's a bad start here. He's got to protect these spine crawlers building before they can get targeted down pretty quickly. Their armors are zero, and look at they come out just in time. Pure Blink Stalkers, so they have to be careful how they engage. Muta Ling can do pretty well against them.
I've been so excited to see his Blinkstalker Micro. It's pretty famous over here talking about it. Really nice Blinkstalker Micro. Gonna trade with the Lings and now get to work on the Spines. Gets one of them down.
Oh, more Lings are out now, but he's trading outside the creep, outside the Spine Crawlers. Maybe he'd want to wait until these Stalkers are taking damage from the Spines as well before he tries to trade out.
Seven more Mutas being made at this point. He's going to have a high number of Mutas, but he needs something to deal with the Stalkers on the ground. The Spines are re-burrowing here.
Oh, they both get DPS down before they could even get one shot off. Now drones being pulled. Mutas on top of the Stalkers here, but this is a great position for Arium.
It really is. The Mutas trying to go for the weakened Stalkers in the back, but once again, the Blink Stalker Micro is insane right now. All the drones being pulled, even the Queen getting to work here. And Arium, I think he may just have this. He's doing so much damage.
Another big warp in as well, or a couple more Stalkers coming in here, and I think he has done the damage. And even if he has to retreat from this point, all the drones are dead in the natural. This is absolutely beautiful play. Great decision-making from Arium to go for this style. Nearly every muter has been wiped up.
And this is going to be a huge win for Arium, man. He is taking out a Korean player right now, although the Lings are coming through here.
They're coming in. A couple more Zealots got warped in. There's only two meters left as well. I think
he lost way too much economy. He's on 25 workers right now.
Exactly. His economy is broken.
One final Muta tries to defend for the Swarm, but it's not going to work out.
Now it's
here.
Up to the Overseers, but unfortunately they can't attack. And he's retreating to the main base, giving up that Spire. It's just a matter of time now.
Symbol may just be in disbelief at this point. I don't think he was expecting this at all. Arium playing a fantastic PvZ series.
Yeah, he must be pretty crushed at this point. Going out of the tournament like this, to a two-base sort of Blinkstalker all in.
He's dancing the units!
why not?
That's going to be it, folks. The American will clean up here. All the drones going down. And Amita's desperately trying to fight. But as Symbol's supply nears the teams, this will be the end of the game. Arium playing a fantastic series overall.
Yeah, really beautiful micro with the Stalkers as well. Everything just went right in this last game. I'd love to see Dance. There we go.
Arium does it.
There we go. Great win from the only American in this tournament.
Yeah, fantastic. He's going to wear that flag now.
Wear it proudly. Great to see it. Symbol, you know, we kind of expected he wouldn't be playing too strongly this tournament, and Arium was way too good for him.
Parading around the scene now. He should feel pretty good about himself, you know. We talked about it before. Symbol, not the highest level Korean, but he's still on Jinner Green Wings, one of these
He's a stepping stone towards the finals, Valdez. It's only a matter of time before we see Arium there.
Who knows, Matt?
His one base immortal play is going to bring him right to the end.
Let's see how many more Zergs he can face up against, and then we'll call and see if he makes it into the finals.
Hey, I'm digging it so far, man. He's done great. We're going to get a chat with him very shortly as well.
I can't wait to see what he has to say about that series. So many questions to ask about that one.
So many questions, especially. Insane. Yeah. Oh, man. It's just so many interesting things. I want to know more about this One Base Immortal style, especially. It's something we just never see.
Yeah. It's awesome to see, you know, as well, from the only American player in the entire bracket. So,
that's right.
You know, we'll see if he has some tips and tricks for other Protoss players to use on these new maps or what he's got to say.
Certainly, sir. Well, we get to that in just a second.
Let's go, guys, right into that interview now with Arian.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the DreamHack Open 2015 Valencia. We have a winner of our first run of 32 match here. My Insanity's Arian. It's good to have you here, man. Great job.
Thanks, man. I don't know what to say. Like, I'm really happy. I mean, I haven't been able to play in WCS at all, so this is a chance for me to finally prove myself again in something competitive.
Is that a one-based, like, Soul Train style, that Immortal All-In style, is that something you can reliably do over and over, even if people know are coming?
To be honest, the reason why I did it on Bridgehead is because it's very, very common for people to do the proxy hatch, which is just a complete build order. And then the reason why I did it in the game, too, is because I didn't have its full potential in the first game. Usually it's supposed to be a move out like that, but I accidentally waited way too long with the extra immortal, so he had Hydras. So that was a big mistake. But honestly, I didn't really know what I was doing that well, so if I didn't know what I was doing, probably he didn't know what I was doing either. So to be honest.
That's good NA Protoss logic. This is pretty much like one of the best results that you've managed to get. Like you said, you're actually too young to play in WCS or most of any other tournaments, really. How does it feel to come out here and kick ass like this?
Honestly, it's just amazing. The feeling is surreal, especially, you know, winning, most importantly, versus Lobo. I didn't think I would ever do that since he actually 2-0'd Rain. So me beating him in PvP was actually amazing. Not only that, but I don't know. It's just amazing. Thank you, My Insanity, for sending me out to Spain. It's a beautiful, beautiful place.
Yeah. Any other questions, guys?
So right now, I guess all the other players who might have underestimated you, now they have to like go into your games, you know, thinking, oh, this guy's going to do a lot of strange things. Do you have a lot more of those strategies prepared, or can you play a more macro-based style?
I could definitely play a macro-based style, but I mean, versus players that are definitely a lot better than me, it's more, you know, more of a better idea to throw something at them that they probably have never played against, especially that one base immortal build. And then after metagaming him, you know, or not him metagaming me, he tried going two base Muta game three, and I went for a blink all in. So that's just a complete build order win.
So when you came to this tournament, did you do any preparation for, oh, you know, if I go really far and I get to the best of five stages, how do I plan for a longer series? Do you think about that at all when you came
here?
No,
I didn't think of that at all, to be honest. I mean, playing in the first group stage, I lost 0-2 to like a not so great Terran player, and I already thought, wow, I'm actually going to do terrible this event. And then going into group stage two, I was able to beat a Bunny for my first game and then Lobo. So I don't know what to say. It's just amazing.
Yeah, I'm really glad to have you here, of course. So we got to chat quite a bit. RM's a good friend of mine. Really glad to hear from you. Guys, we're going to start off with our round of 16 matches coming up next. We're going to go to a short commercial break, and when we come back, more awesome StarCraft II action. You're watching DreamHack Open 2015 Valencia. We'll be right back.